to another Amazingly Average game review. My name is Anthony, and the game I'm going to be reviewing today is Dragon Age Origins. It is developed by BioWare and published by EA Games, and it's a fantasy-based RPG that takes place in the world of Thedas, primarily in the land of Ferelden. And the kind of backstory to it is way in the past, with the Chantry, the main religious group within Dragon Age Origins, kind of says that the Treventor mages, very powerful mages that were kind of kept unchecked, believe that they were so powerful they can go ahead and overthrow the Maker himself. So, in an act of such hubris, they kind of find a way to breach from the physical world into, force their way in, the Golden City. Upon doing so, however, it's said that they corrupted the Golden City and turned it to black. And for doing so, the Maker cast them back down into the world of Thedas, but also corrupted them, just twisting their form into these vile creatures known as the First Darkspawn. And the Darkspawn have a taint within them that works like a slow, horrible poison to anything it touches, but also corrupts whatever land they come across. And it's just bad news all around. And you have a Grey Warden, which is a group of elite warriors, mages, just many different people who are capable of fighting, that are the most capable of fighting the Darkspawn for reasons that are revealed throughout the game, to try and take on this threat. And he senses that there's another blight on the way. And the way that that happens is a blight occurs whenever the Darkspawn, who are primarily down in the Deep Roads, are constantly digging and searching for old gods that were imprisoned by the Maker. And when they find such an old god, just being near them kind of taints and corrupts the old gods, turning them to the Archdemon, which is the hive mind that controls the Darkspawn, kind of sends them to the surface to just attack and just ravish everything. So trying to stop this, Duncan is doing his best to try and warn everybody of the oncoming blight. Unfortunately, because it's been so long, people don't see the Grey Wardens in the same light that they should be, considering they've kind of saved Thedas on several different occasions. And so, the beauty of Dragon Age Origins is you have up to 6 different origins to choose from. And the way that works is you go ahead and choose your race, whether you decide you want to be a human, an elf, or a dwarf. You can go ahead and choose your class, whether you want to be a warrior, a rogue, or a mage. And then from there, based on those different options, you have the choice of kind of choosing your origin story through those different options that are available. And the way it works is, with those 6 different origins, it's not like other games to where, okay, you have a different kind of backstory, but you always play the same beginning. That's not the case. With the 6 different origin stories, you get a different kind of beginning, which acts not only as a tutorial on how to play the game, but also provides an interesting backstory to each character and different experiences that you see throughout the game. Now, even though you may choose only just one origin, you also notice when you play throughout the game, there's definitely little nods and references to the other origins that you didn't pick. So I really think that was a nice touch on BioWare's part for doing so. But near the end of your origin story, one way or another, you kind of run into Duncan and you end up becoming part of the Grey Wardens through a ritual. And going through the game, unfortunately, you're betrayed. I'm not going to say how or when, but it results in only just you and one other person being the last of the Grey Wardens, and you have the Grey Warden treaties. So the idea is to take those treaties that allow you to kind of conscript other groups that are supposed to help out the Grey Wardens during a blight, to get them to come together and kind of stop this blight before it even happens. The way combat is handled is very similar to Star Wars Knights of the Republic. For anybody who's not familiar with that, another easy way to kind of explain it is, if you're familiar with it, it's similar to Dungeons & Dragons. It's heavily stat-based. You're able to really kind of tinker around with your character to cater to your own playstyle. Whether in the case of warrior, you're going to be a sword and board, like sword and shield kind of warrior, two-weapon warrior, two-handed weapon warrior, and so on. So there's a lot of different room to play around with. And whenever you go to level up, you have the option of distributing the points however you see fit. I would highly recommend anybody unfamiliar with how RPGs or just Dungeons & Dragons works to kind of consider the playstyle and the classes you've chosen before kind of putting your points into those different areas. For instance, if you're going to be a warrior, generally what you want to focus on is strength, which is going to allow you to be less likely to miss and also affect your damage. You want to go ahead and try and focus on constitution. That's kind of your health pool and fortitude. And then you also want to focus on your willpower, which gives you stamina to use a lot of your different abilities. As a rogue, for instance, you really won't want to focus too much on constitution. You really want to try and think of where you're going to be going and how you want to distribute those stats. Otherwise, it can make the game a little bit more difficult for you. So unless you want a challenge, or maybe there's a specific build you're going for, definitely consider that. And the way it's handled is it works in one of two ways. It's primarily done through real time. You go ahead and choose to either auto attack or use abilities. So you're kind of just sitting there, whack, whack, whack. Which isn't as boring as it sounds, because generally you're going to be using your abilities anyways, along with your other companions who also have their own abilities. And the beauty of that is, besides the real-time combat, you can kind of pause for a more tactical approach where it freezes time, and you can go between not only yourself but your different companions and usher out different orders to use certain special abilities and so on, and then go straight back in normal combat to where you kind of see that unfold. So there's a little bit of strategy involved in that kind of gameplay as well. And the beauty of it is, too, is there's different combinations during combat. For instance, if you have a mage, they can go ahead and freeze an opponent, and then as a warrior, if you're quick enough and you succeed on the check, you can go ahead and do like a shield bash and they shatter. Or you can go ahead and set, for instance, a grease trap if you have that skill, and then you can have a mage light that grease trap on fire, causing a huge blaze. So there's a lot of teamwork involved in that respect as well. As I mentioned, you have the ability to pick certain abilities as you level up, and the skills are more along the lines of professions, like the ability to use diplomacy, trap making, poison making, being able to survive a little bit easier, herbalism to make different potions that you might need or your party members might need, and so on. The one thing I almost forgot to mention is at level 7 and level 14, you can go ahead and unlock specializations for your character. The way specializations work, they give you a one-time bonus to your attributes, and they unlock an additional tree of different talents for abilities, both passive, active, or sustained, that you can kind of use for your character. It also kind of, for people like me, adds to the lore. For instance, a warrior, you have the choice of choosing either a berserker, a templar, a champion, or a reaver. So for the sake of kind of the character I built, which was a human, noble, sword and board fighter, I thought maybe it made more sense for him to be kind of like a Templar in some of his abilities, as well as a champion. And like I said, it gives you those bonuses, allows you to kind of further customize your character, not only on the battlefield, but also even for story-wise. And the way you get those specializations, besides unlocking them at 714, to actually get them as a choice, they can be obtained in a few different ways. Previously mentioned, when you speak to different characters, for instance like Ogryn, who is a berserker, or even Alistair, who happens to be a Templar, you can go ahead and upon becoming good enough friends with them, learning enough about them, they can offer to teach you that specialization. Otherwise, you can go ahead and find tomes, or even through different events, which you can basically find by exploring, you can get the ability to unlock those other specializations as well, through those actions. In classic BioWare fashion, throughout the game, there's several different choices that you can make that affect not only the story itself, but also who may align with you to go ahead and take on the Blight, and even what companions, the way they treat you, whether you can gain favor from them or end up pissing them off, or just other things with them, in regards to, like I said, just different choices that you make. And even with companions, you have different dialogue choices, different actions that you have by having them in the party, or even just gifts that can go ahead and be used to either gain favor or end up pissing them off. And by gaining enough favor, not only do they get stat bonuses, but you can go ahead and unlock side missions with said companion. You can get a lot of interesting lore from the story from them. And I think I already said stat bonuses, so I'm kind of repeating myself at that point. But on the flip side, if you piss them off enough, you can get to a point to where you can go ahead, they'll either leave the party on their own, you can tell them to leave if you don't even like having them around. You may not even get the chance to recruit them if you don't run into them, or based on your actions alone, you can piss them off to the point that they will flat out attack you and you're going to have to be forced to kill them. So it's interesting to see a game kind of have that kind of effect in regards to how you make different choices and what you do throughout the game, how that can actually play out. The dialogue is broken down into several different pieces which kind of lead down different dialogue trees. So you really want to kind of think before you make certain choices, because you can go either based on what you're trying to say to the person, gather more information, or if you say a certain thing, it may end the conversation altogether. It may, again, just like your companions, piss them off to where you'll provoke an attack, or you may even be able to persuade or intimidate and get yourself out of combat altogether based on the different dialogue options, which is a lot of fun and ends up being many different situations you kind of run into even through multiple playthroughs based on just even just the dialogue choices you choose on its own. And that's part of what makes this game so great, is because not only based on the choices that you make throughout the game, but also through the different origin stories and so on, there is a really vast amount of replayability that you generally don't see in a lot of games in general, sometimes in RPGs, depending on it. And it's the beauty of it is you kind of create a story that is your own. And even to this day, there's different people that have different visions of who their warden was and what they've done and everything that's got them to that point. And it's great to trade stories, and that's something that's awesome that certain games such as Dragon Age can actually allow their players to do. The graphics of the game are not the best. It does seem a little bit dated, and when you kind of look at the character designs, I'm not even going to get started on their teeth. I guess maybe they're kind of going for a more realistic approach considering it's more like medieval times, so bad teeth is to be expected. Nitpicking aside, considering I'm not really one who thinks too much upon the graphics or tends to look harshly at the game because of it, like I said, it is still a little bit dated for an Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, PC game. The environments, however, are still very beautiful. There's a lot of different locations you kind of go through. At one point, you even take a trip through the Fade, which is supposed to be a dreamlike world that where you go to when you dream that's filled with several different demons, and it's just a really crazy place to be. So it does really well in that regards. The character designs, like I said, they could have used a little bit of work, but it's not too big of a deal. Now, what I love about this game, as I mentioned before, is I am a huge sucker for the ability to go ahead and create your own character, create your own story, and make your own choices. It's the one thing that BioWare really excels at, and the one thing that I really enjoy about them as a company. And there's just a whole lot of replayability because of it, so you're really getting a lot of value for the game that you've purchased, which is what makes Dragon Age Origins so great. The only real downside I would have to say to the game would be the graphics, only to a certain extent. I mean, it's not really enough to say that the game's awful because of it, or the graphics themselves are truly awful. I feel like it could just be a little bit better, even for its time and the consoles and just platform that they were on. And the combat. The one thing I didn't mention about the combat, which is kind of an issue for a lot of people that's run into it, is when you're an actual melee fighter, you kind of have to get situated, and it's weird because you'll have the little circle that's supposed to represent the area of where you're trying to attack the enemy. If you have most of your party as melee fighters, or even if there's just other NPCs that are helping you attack too, or even just in awkward situations for some reason, your character's kind of just shifting around trying to figure out where they're supposed to be before they'll finally start attacking or using ability. And on harder difficulties, or even just in certain situations, that can be the difference of life or death, which can be a real pain and can be very frustrating for the player. Now, I was fighting with actually coming up with a score for this game, because in truth, the Dragon Age series is one of my favorite series of all time. I'd actually have to say it is my favorite series of all time. So I was trying to come up with a fair score that wouldn't seem biased, but at the same time, I didn't want to score it too low, where people would think, oh, you're just doing that because you didn't want to come off as biased. But after giving it some serious thought, I would have to give Dragon Age Origins a 9 out of 10. Again, I mean, the only thing that was keeping it from truly being a perfect game was mostly just the bugs with combat, and even just some of the bugs that are experienced through the game, some of them being game-breaking, which still haven't been fixed to this day, but are rare and very hard to come by and don't happen often. But they say the combat bug was just a real pain, and it surfaced more times than I would care to admit. And the graphics, again, like I said, could have used a little bit of updating. That's the only thing that really kept it from being a 9.5 or higher. But definitely the one thing I would recommend is if you are a fan of RPGs, it's definitely a very interesting lore. There's a lot of replayability. The game's still a lot of fun. There's still so much more to do with it, and there's a lot of freedom and creativity to this. I would definitely recommend buying it and adding it to your collection. And even further, to some of the expansions, they don't take away from the story, but they definitely add to it. That's not really affecting the score, but I would still recommend looking into those as well. So I hope you found this review helpful and that you enjoyed the information that I provided. And thanks for watching. Until next time. And then you still have this voice still taunting. It's like, you know, call upon the maker, you cannot. And then you just see this figure, and there's a lot of speculation behind this, sometimes in RPGs, depending on it. And it's the beauty of it is you kind of create a story that is your own. And even to this day, there's different people that have different visions of who their warden was and what they've done and everything that's got them to that point. And it's great to trade stories, and that's something that's awesome that certain games, such as Dragon Age, can actually allow their players to do. The graphics of the game are not the best. It does seem a little bit dated, and when you kind of look at the character designs, I'm not even going to get started on their teeth. I guess maybe they're kind of going for a more realistic approach, considering it's more like medieval times, so bad teeth is to be expected. Nitpicking aside, considering I'm not really one who thinks too much upon the graphics or tends to look harshly at the game because of it, like I said, it is still a little bit dated for an Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, PC game. The environments, however, are still very beautiful. There's a lot of different locations you kind of go through. At one point, you even take a trip through the Fade, which is supposed to be a dreamlike world that where you go to when you dream that's filled with several different demons, and it's just a really crazy place to be. So it does really well in that regards. The character designs, like I said, they could have used a little bit of work, but it's not too big of a deal. Now, what I love about this game, as I mentioned before, is I am a huge sucker for the ability to go ahead and create your own character, create your own story, make your own choices. It's the one thing that BioWare really excels at, and the one thing that I really enjoy about them as a company. And there's just a whole lot of replayability because of it, so you're really getting a lot of value for the game that you've purchased, which is what makes Dragon Age Origins so great. The only real downside I would have to say to the game would be the graphics, only to a certain extent. I mean, it's not really enough to say that the game's awful because of it, or the graphics themselves are truly awful. I feel like it could just be a little bit better, even for its time and the consoles and just platform that they were on. And the combat. The one thing I didn't mention about the combat, which is kind of an issue for a lot of people that's run into it, is when you're an actual melee fighter, you kind of have to get situated, and it's weird because you'll have the little circle that's supposed to represent the area of where you're trying to attack the enemy. If you have most of your party as melee fighters, or even if there's just other NPCs that are helping you attack too, or even just in awkward situations for some reason, your character's kind of just shifting around a rogue or a mage, and then from there, based on those different options, you have the choice of kind of choosing your origin story through those different options that are available. And the way it works is, with those six different origins, it's not like other games to where, okay, you have a different kind of backstory, but you always play the same beginning. That's not the case. With the six different origin stories, you get a different kind of beginning, which acts not only as a tutorial on how to play the game, but also provides an interesting backstory to each character and different experiences that you see throughout the game. Now, even though you may choose only just one origin, you also notice when you play throughout the game, there's definitely little nods and references to the other origins that you didn't pick. So I really think that was a nice touch on BioWare's part for doing so. But near the end of your origin story, one way or another, you kind of run into Duncan and you end up becoming part of the Grey Wardens through a ritual. And going through the game, unfortunately, you're betrayed. I'm not going to say how or when, but it results in only just you and one other person being the last of the Grey Wardens, and you have the Grey Warden treaties. So the idea is to take those treaties that allow you to kind of conscript other groups that are supposed to help out the Grey Wardens during a blight, to get them to come together and kind of stop this blight before it even happens. The way combat is handled is very similar to Star Wars Knights of the Republic. For anybody who's not familiar with that, another easy way to kind of explain it is, if you're familiar with it, it's similar to Dungeons & Dragons. It's heavily stat-based. You're able to really kind of tinker around with your character to cater to your own playstyle. Whether in the case of Warrior, you're going to be a sword and board, like sword and shield kind of warrior, two-weapon warrior, two-handed weapon warrior, and so on. So there's a lot of different room to play around with. And whenever you go to level up, you have the option of distributing the points however you see fit. I would highly recommend anybody unfamiliar with how RPGs or just Dungeons & Dragons works to kind of consider the playstyle and the classes you've chosen before kind of putting your points into those different areas. For instance, if you're going to be a warrior, generally what you want to focus on is strength, which is going to allow you to be less likely to miss and also affects your damage. You want to go ahead and try and focus on constitution, that's kind of your health pool and fortitude. And then you also want to focus on your willpower, which gives you stamina to use a lot of your different abilities. As a rogue, for instance, you really won't want to focus too much on constitution. You really want to try and think of where you're going to be going and how you want to distribute those stats. Otherwise, welcome to another Amazingly Average game review. My name is Anthony, and the game I'm going to be reviewing today is Dragon Age Origins. It is developed by BioWare and published by EA Games. And it's a fantasy-based RPG that takes place in the world of Thedas, primarily in the land of Ferelden. And the kind of backstory to it is way in the past, with the Chantry, the main religious group that's within Dragon Age Origins, kind of says that the Devinter mages, very powerful mages that were kind of kept unchecked, believe that they were so powerful they can go ahead and overthrow the Maker himself. So, in an act of such hubris, they kind of find a way to reach from the physical world into, force their way in, the Golden City. Upon doing so, however, it's said that they corrupted the Golden City and turned it to black. And for doing so, the Maker cast them back down into the world of Thedas, but also corrupted them, just twisting their form into these vile creatures known as the First Darkspawn. And the Darkspawn have a taint within them that works like a slow, horrible poison to anything it touches, but also corrupts whatever land they come across. And it's just bad news all around. And you have a Grey Warden, which is a group of elite warriors, mages, just many different people who are capable of fighting, that are the most capable of fighting the Darkspawn, for reasons that are revealed throughout the game, to try and take on this threat. And he senses that there's another blight on the way. And the way that that happens is a blight occurs whenever the Darkspawn, who are primarily down in the Deep Roads, are constantly digging and searching for old gods that were imprisoned by the Maker. And when they find such an old god, just being near them kind of taints and corrupts the old gods, turning them to the Archdemon, which is the hive mind that controls the Darkspawn, kind of sends them to the surface to just attack and just ravish everything. So trying to stop this, Duncan is doing his best to try and warn everybody of the oncoming blight. Unfortunately, because it's been so long, people don't see the Grey Wardens in the same light that they should be, considering they've kind of saved Thedas on several different occasions. And so, the beauty of Dragon Age Origins is you have up to 6 different origins to choose from. And the way that works is you go ahead and choose your race, whether you decide you want to be a human, an elf, or a dwarf. You can go ahead and choose your class, whether you want to be a warrior. It can make the game a little bit more difficult for you. So unless you want a challenge, or maybe there's a specific build you're going for, definitely consider that. And the way it's handled is it works in one of two ways. It's primarily done through real time. You go ahead and choose to either auto attack or use abilities. So you're kind of just sitting there, whack, whack, whack. Which isn't as boring as it sounds, because generally you're going to be using your abilities anyways, along with your other companions who also have their own abilities. And the beauty of that is, besides the real-time combat, you can kind of pause for a more tactical approach where it freezes time, and you can go between not only yourself, but your different companions, and usher out different orders to use certain special abilities and so on, and then go straight back in normal combat to where you kind of see that unfold. So there's a little bit of strategy involved in that kind of gameplay as well. And the beauty of it is, too, is there's different combinations during combat. For instance, if you have a mage, they can go ahead and freeze an opponent, and then as a warrior, if you're quick enough and you succeed on the check, you can go ahead and do like a shield bash and they shatter. Or you can go ahead and set, for instance, a grease trap if you have that skill, and then you can have a mage light that grease trap on fire, causing a huge blaze. So there's a lot of teamwork involved in that respect as well. As I mentioned, you have the ability to pick certain abilities as you level up, and the skills are more along lines of professions, like the ability to use diplomacy, trap making, poison making, being able to survive a little bit easier, herbalism to make different potions that you might need or your party members might need, and so on. The one thing I almost forgot to mention is at level 7 and level 14, you can go ahead and unlock specializations for your character. The way specializations work, they give you a one-time bonus to your attributes, and they unlock an additional tree of different talents for abilities, both passive, active, or sustained, that you can kind of use for your character. It also kind of, for people like me, adds to the lore. For instance, a warrior, you have the choice of choosing either a berserker, a templar, a champion, or a reaver. So for the sake of kind of the character I built, which was a human, noble, sword and board fighter, I thought maybe it made more sense for him to be kind of like a templar in some of his abilities, as well as a champion. And like I said, it gives you those bonuses, allows you to kind of further customize your character, not only on the battlefield, but also even for story-wise. And the way you get those specializations, besides unlocking them at 714, to actually get them as a choice, they can be obtained in a few different ways. Previously mentioned, when you speak to different characters, for instance like Ogryn, who is a berserker, or even Alistair, who happens to be a Templar, you can go ahead and upon becoming good enough friends with them, learning enough about them, they can offer to teach you that specialization. Otherwise, you can go ahead and find tomes, or even through different events, which you can basically find by exploring, you can get the ability to unlock those other specializations as well, through those actions. In classic BioWare fashion, throughout the game, there's several different choices that you can make that affect not only the story itself, but also who may align with you to go ahead and take on the Blight, and even what companions, the way they treat you, whether you can gain favor from them or end up pissing them off, or just other things with them, in regards to, like I said, just different choices that you make. And even with companions, you have different dialogue choices, different actions that you have by having them in the party, or even just gifts that can go ahead and be used to either gain favor or end up pissing them off. And by gaining enough favor, not only do they get stat bonuses, but you can go ahead and unlock side missions with said companion. You can get a lot of interesting lore from the story from them. And I think I already said stat bonuses, so I'm kind of repeating myself at that point. But on the flip side, if you piss them off enough, you can get to a point to where you can go ahead, they'll either leave the party on their own, you can tell them to leave if you don't even like having them around. You may not even get the chance to recruit them if you don't run into them. Or based on your actions alone, you can piss them off to the point that they will flat out attack you and you're going to have to be forced to kill them. So it's interesting to see a game kind of have that kind of effect in regards to how you make different choices and what you do throughout the game, how that can actually play out. The dialogue is broken down into several different pieces, which kind of lead down different dialogue trees. So you really want to kind of think before you make certain choices, because you can go either, based on what you're trying to say to the person, gather more information, or if you say a certain thing, it may end the conversation altogether. It may, again, just like your companions, piss them off to where you'll provoke an attack, or you may even be able to persuade or intimidate and get yourself out of combat altogether based on the different dialogue options, which is a lot of fun. And ends up being many different situations you kind of go run into, even through multiple playthroughs, based on just the dialogue choices you choose on its own. And that's part of what makes this game so great, is because not only based on the choices that you make throughout the game, but also through the different origin stories and so on, there is a really vast amount of replayability that you generally don't see in a lot of games in general.